Ambassador Sam Fabrizi, thanks for joining us on Europe Now.
It's a pleasure to be here, Anthony.
Ambassador, in the wake of the global financial crisis, the financial bailout of Greece, and now with Brexit looming, the EU in 2016 is facing huge challenges. I wonder what's your assessment of how the EU has been coping with and responding to these difficulties?
Well, Anthony, thank you for the question. I would say that it's looking from an outside point of view, certainly we are not going through an easy period in Europe, but we have to remember that each of those challenges you made have their own dynamic, their own history, and you cannot just pile them up under a single framework. The difficulties we have on the global financial crisis are largely behind us. The economy is back on track. Both the Eurozone, so the 19 countries of we share the same currency, and the 28 are already growing since 2 years. Certainly, Greece is a country that needs special help, and the European Union member state and Commission are working on with the Greece very, very closely. And you made a reference to a referendum that we prefer to call UK in the EU rather than Brexit. At least this is our hashtag in Brussels. It's something that we are looking forward to see what the British people will decide.
On the topic of global shocks, arguably nowhere has that been more evident than in the current migration crisis. 2016 has seen many governments across the continent, some say, abdicating responsibility. Some have even argued that the EU now faces an ethical catastrophe of historic proportions. What's your response to the critics and the skeptics?
Migration certainly is a big issue. The UNHCR said that we have 60 million refugees. For one reason or another one, a large part of these displaced and refugees are around our borders. So we live in Europe from the eastern border to the southern border. We are facing a very important migration crisis. We are responding with our tool, which is based on European Union legislation and international legislation. So rather than saying the member state abdicating, as some critics suggest, I would say that Europe is not abdicating because we are dealing with an unprecedented migration flow respecting our law. Certainly it's difficult to manage 1.2 million migrants as Europe managed in 2015 respecting the EU and international law, but we did it. So I wouldn't say that Europe is abdicating. Europe is going through a difficult situation without abdicating to its own law.
Ambassador, the European Commission has also been working to secure agreement for the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, TTIP, by the end of the year. Advocates say that it will harmonise regulatory standards and help companies to do more transatlantic business. Critics have been warning that it's going to weaken environmental and consumer standards. What's your take on this?
Certainly, this is the most ambitious agreement we ever had. We ever have a launch. That will be the first and the second economy, depending on the number. For us, we are the largest economy in terms of GDP than the US. But in any case, that will be the biggest ever bilateral agreement. Mm-hmm. Our commitment is, of course, to make the agreement at the highest level. And there's a commitment on both sides, on the US and our side, to look not the minimum denominator, but the maximum one. And that's why the negotiations always are complex. So to those critics who say we will lower the standard, not just me, but certainly the negotiators say this is not the case, because we have the mandate, the Commission had before entering into negotiation need to have a mandate from the 28 member states. And if you look at the mandate, you find nowhere a mandate where the Commission is tasked to lower our standard. On the contrary, we have to fix our standard at the highest level. And I think this is the same commitment by the US side. Of course, it's the biggest ever negotiation also because it's the 21st century FTA are no longer about tariff. That, as you said, about regulatory framework. and to put together all the stakeholders in this exercise to harmonize the standard of security, safety, food control, labeling, etc. You need to involve all the agency at the federal, sub-federal level. So it's a very complex agreement. We hope that we will get a deal by the end of the year. But of course, negotiators are those who can give us more updated information.
Climate change remains top of the political agenda in Europe and much of the world, and the EU's been a vital contributor to global progress on progressive carbon targets and action. Where do you see this heading in the coming period after the Paris Agreement?
The European Union has started its own climate action already 20 years ago. It's not by chance that we are now only the third big polluter after US and China, because we have already very stringent legislation since at least 15 years. And our messages to the negotiation has been climate change need to be tackled, because climate change is a reality, the science tell us. But at the same time, we said the climate and economic, climate action and economic growth are compatible. It's not a zero-sum game. So you see that you can grow, you can reduce emission. There's no contrast like that. I think this message passes through. And I think the for us right now will be how to bring the whole European family, the whole global family, in this long journey. We have to provide assistance, we have to provide financial means to mitigate, to update, especially the vulnerable countries.
Australian Prime Minister Malcolm Turnbull has recently underscored the utter centrality of innovation to the Australian economy and its engagement with the region and globally. Of course, Europe and the European Union has done innovation, and it's done it in spades for a long time. What, in your opinion, have we got to learn from the EU, and through this partnership between Australia and the EU, how can we best prosper with this focus on innovation?
Difficult to give lesson to a country and to a sitting prime minister. What I say that is that this policy of NISA, the National Innovation Strategy for Australia, that the government has launched last December, is very much welcome, I presume, not only in Australia, but certainly also in Europe. We decide to invest on policies that can create growth and opportunity. And that's why almost 80 billion euro, which is 120 Australian billion dollars, have been put on innovation through our flagship program Horizon 2020. Because we thought, and we believe, we are convinced, that innovation can create growth, and growth can create job and opportunities. So for us, innovation is one of the main policies, together with trade, for example, how to promote trade. Trade as an engine for growth. The prospect is the same. We've already been working with Australia throughout the last budget. We already have 80 nearly so project finance, moving $300 million under the Horizon 2020. We are sure that with the new emphasis on coming from NISA, this cooperation can further increase.
Ambassador, many thanks for joining us on Europe Now.
Thank you very much. It's been a real pleasure.